heard CoffeeScript, don't know what it is, or have some idea.
Okay, that's probably more than half. That's good.
CoffeeScript is basically JavaScript, but with smaller, more expressive syntax, some extra features like classes, some syntactic differences, for example, it has significant white space, and has various other kind of tweaks and improvements and shortcuts compared to classic JavaScript. And the way CoffeeScript works is it simply takes, write your code in CoffeeScript, run it through the CoffeeScript compiler, and what comes out the other side is ordinary JavaScript that will run in any web browser or server-side JavaScript service such as node.js. Ordinary JavaScript with no magic, with nothing else going on, just plain simple JavaScript. And the way I kind of like to think of it is comparing, say, using jQuery to doing DOM manipulation directly. So, way back 6, 7, 8 years ago, when anyone wanted to write JavaScript code, we were told to manipulate the DOM directly. And then jQuery came along and said, you don't need to do all of that, you don't need to know about all these differences across different browsers and different environments. Just use these methods, it's a lot simpler, it's a lot quicker. All these common tasks that you had to have written 5, 6, 7 lines of code to do, you can now do in 1 or 2 lines using jQuery. And it kind of gives you, as a developer, CoffeeScript kind of gives you a similar kind of boost. It gives you the ability to do something that will take 5 or 6 or 7 lines of code in JavaScript, do it in 2 or 3 lines of code in CoffeeScript. And based on my own sort of experience, you can write the equivalent code that does the same thing in about 2/3 the number of lines in CoffeeScript compared to JavaScript. And that's not just lines of code, that's also characters. So if you wrote 10 kilobytes of JavaScript, you're looking at maybe 6 or 7 kilobytes of CoffeeScript to do exactly the same thing. So a lot of the keywords are shorter, a lot of the common patterns there are built-in keywords for them or built-in language constructs to do those. So you don't need to write a lot of boilerplate JavaScript code that you might normally have to, or in the worst case scenario, copy and paste the same thing around to do the same thing multiple times. I've got a key question is why do you need to do this? Why now? It's impossible to do what you've been doing CoffeeScript for a long time. There's nothing to have stopped anybody writing their own language that compiled down to JavaScript 6 or 7 years ago. Why is it now, in the last couple of years, that people are starting looking at this as a viable option? I think for me, the reason is that development, client-side development is changing. The kind of things that we're being asked to do as developers are different and more complicated. I remember when jQuery was first added to Drupal core, and what everybody kind of thought it was for was, you know, visual effects. It was, you know, rather than just delivering a flat web page to people, you deliver this web page that's interactive. You click on things, you have animations, fade in, fade out, and kind of for a while you just got lots of web pages with lots and lots of fading effects going on for no good reason, just because people thought it was cool. But what we're starting to see now is actually what you deliver to the browser is just the start. That is meant to be an interactive application. You're meant to be able to send requests back and forth to the server in a single page without reloading the whole page. You're expected to be able to manage complex user interfaces with their own kind of subcomponents and widgets and so on and so forth. And trying to do that using just plain jQuery is actually quite difficult. Just identifying the areas of the page based on CSS classes and ideas is that's leading people to want to create these much more complicated frameworks. Things like Backbone.js, which is going to be included in Drupal core and Drupal 8. And there's also other frameworks like Ember and Knockout. And these have full object-oriented MVC models for the browser, which is much more complicated. So we're kind of going through the same process that PHP went through a few years ago, then, moving away from just doing simple functions to having classes and objects and a full kind of object-oriented framework. So those kind of requirements are becoming more commonplace, but doing them in JavaScript is actually quite painful at times. It was never really designed as a fully-fledged object-oriented system. You can do objects in it, you can do inheritance, but the syntax is clunky, it takes a lot of time. And CoffeeScript comes along and says, well, instead of having all these different ways of doing it, instead of having your own kind of homebrew object-oriented system in JavaScript, or your own homebrew MVC kind of approach. Here's a class keyword for you. Just use the class keyword, and you can extend, you can inherit, you can add methods to classes, you can instantiate classes. You can do it like this. So it kind of makes doing the right thing easy. It takes a standardized approach, so just do it like this. Most of the time. And you might find, obviously, as with all things, it doesn't do exactly what you want to do every single time. But underlying CoffeeScript is JavaScript. You have the full power of JavaScript available to you. Anything you can do in JavaScript, you can do in CoffeeScript. If you really, really want to, you can inline JavaScript into your CoffeeScript. So you can be in the middle of a CoffeeScript function and think, I know how to do this in JavaScript, but not CoffeeScript. You can put backtick quotes around it, and you can actually put your own inline JavaScript within the CoffeeScript file. So you're not being cut off from anything that you could do in JavaScript, you're just being your intellectual tool that might make your life a little bit easier. As I said before, there's no magic, there's no kind of behind the scenes trickery. You can actually read the JavaScript code that comes out of the CoffeeScript very quickly. Produces very concise, very straightforward JavaScript. Your variable names will stay the same, your function names will stay the same. So it's quite easy if you're a reasonably proficient JavaScript developer, you can look side by side with your CoffeeScript and JavaScript to see exactly what's going on and exactly how things will work. So what I'm going to do now, and this is probably going to take the bulk of the talk, is I'm going to walk through some examples of some code. I'm going to show how it's done in CoffeeScript, how it's done in JavaScript, and kind of draw some comparisons. And what I'd like to ask is, if you've got any questions, just raise your hand at the time, and don't wait until the end. It's a lot easier to answer those questions when the code is up and we can all kind of look at it. So feel free to interrupt at any point if you have a question or just raise your hand. And the first thing to say, just in order to be able to read CoffeeScript code properly, you really need to understand the importance of white space. If any of you have ever done Python development, you would have seen this before, but this is quite new. It doesn't happen in Java, it doesn't happen in PHP, it doesn't happen in C, and it doesn't happen in JavaScript either. But in CoffeeScript, white space is significant. So that means how far you embed things actually makes a difference to how the code runs. So in this example here, we've got some CoffeeScript at the top and some JavaScript underneath it. And what you can see immediately about the JavaScript is there are these standard brackets around the code box, and that shows kind of how the control flow works. We've got an if statement, and then we open the brackets up to say these are the things that will be executed if this if statement is true, and we close the brackets when we say we're finished with that, and we want to do another statement, which in this case is an else statement. Then we open the brackets again, and we then things, and when we close the bracket, that's it, we're finished with that piece of code. In CoffeeScript, that's all done through indentation. So you see the top line is the if statement, and anything that is two spaces indented from that executes if the if statement is true. We'll be going to come out of that if statement, we just go back two spaces, and then we put in the else, and we do the same again there with the indentation. So it's just really, really important to keep in mind when you're looking at the code, there aren't going to be any brackets explaining these things. It is all done through white space. It is two spaces, and that's standardized across the piece. And three spaces doesn't work. So that kind of thing will generate compiler in CoffeeScript. So if you indent things incorrectly, it will generally cause compiler error. It can sometimes catch up. Sometimes you indent things incorrectly, and you still produce valid code, and that code will run. It just does the wrong thing. So you have to be a little bit careful. But after you've been doing it for about a week or so, it really becomes second nature.
What white
space
is
at the end of the
ones? Is that
having an effect? No.
It's obviously
you can't see them. No, I actually have my editor set up to show white space, so I do see the white space at the end of the lines. But as a general principle, no, the white space at the end of the line doesn't make any difference. I use Optimax. I think most editors can.
Well, in detail, there's a functional events changing different events. I mean, I've seen Python code and they did, but I don't see the advantage of that or having sort of explicit marker, but
Well, you can still put the explicit brackets in. There's no rule against doing so, but they're not strictly necessary. So the white space is used by default. The idea is to basically cut down the number of keystrokes, cut down the number of things that you need to do. It does sometimes enable you to write very, very terse code. So code that almost reads like English, there's nothing kind of getting in the way of the code, obviously, like, it's no symbols. But no, it's a completely a matter of choice. I think what is interesting, obviously, is that the indentation is exactly the same between the CoffeeScript and the JavaScript. CoffeeScript basically says you must do best practice indentation. JavaScript says you probably should. So if you do the same indentation in CoffeeScript that you should be doing in the JavaScript,
can versus compile in, like, say you just ask pure habit to curly braces and a semicolon at the end of your line, will it compile in CoffeeScript?
Yes. It will compile, it's just not necessary. Okay. It is, yes. I mean, you can't entirely paste a chunk of JavaScript code in, but if you I'm going on pure muscle memory, if you just type those symbols in because you're used to doing that, it generally works. So I'm just going to show an example here. This is an example of a function declaration at the top. So it's a lot shorter than it would be in JavaScript, there's no function keyword. But all we're doing there is we're saying we've got a variable called square, and we're going to set that to a value, and that value is a function. And the way you tell something is a function in CoffeeScript is you just have those parentheses. You see parentheses anywhere in that kind of situation, with the arrow after it, it's a function. So that kind of dash and then greater than symbol indicates that it's a function in combination with the parentheses. So that's a function that says a single parameter called x, and then you then see the body of that function, and that's just x times x. And you might think that's a pretty useless function because it's not returning anything. But actually, CoffeeScript is very, very similar to Ruby in that respect. It basically takes what, if you have the last line in your function is actually a variable, it will return that. So, appreciate that. It might take a moment of kind of wrapping your head around. But what that function is doing there is it's basically saying x times x equals some value. And since that's our last line, we're just going to assume that that's what's meant to be returned. So it's going to return x times x. So you can see the number of characters there. You've got to add a function keyword, you've got to add a return keyword, you've got to add the braces, you've got to have a semicolon at the end. Whereas in CoffeeScript, there's practically no syntax at all. You've just got the parentheses for your parameters and the dash arrow symbol for say this function. So it probably takes about half the number of characters. Not that the number of characters is everything. You just want to back up a very, very small inline function to do something. It takes a lot less space. And then we have an object declaration here. So we're saying we've got an object called math, and then we have some properties of that object, one called root, one called square, and one called cube. The square is set to the value of the square function that we declared earlier. Cube is actually declaring a new function in line. So you can see it's a function that we have the parentheses on the arrow. And again, we're taking that parameter x, we're multiplying it by square x because we need to take a square function, pass x into it, and multiply that value by x. So this probably makes a bit more sense if I show you the JavaScript version. We have here an object, a written declaration, and again you can see we've got the curly braces being used and the semicolon again. And to do that inline function, which was a one-liner in CoffeeScript, that's now become three lines, with function keyword in the curly braces, the return, and the semicolon. So it's a kind of much longer, more long-winded way of doing exactly the same thing. And this code here is actually the CoffeeScript output. So if you took the first lot of code and ran it through the CoffeeScript compiler, this is what you would get out. So it's the same, exactly the same thing, you know, as a developer, you can look at side by side and say, I wrote this code and this is the output that it produced. So, you know, you've got that ability to kind of interrogate the output yourself. This is a little bit weirder. We've got a few things going on here that look quite non-standard from a JavaScript point of view. We've got something at the top here which says call this function if ignition is on. So the if statement is actually coming after the thing you want it to do. But speaking personally, I'm not a massive fan of this approach. I actually think this is quite confusing to people, and I find it quite confusing. But it is possible to do. If you just have one thing you want to do, you can write that one thing there, and then put the if statement after it, and it will only happen if that if statement is evaluated to true. So the only reason you really do that is if you really, really wanted your code to read by getting your sentence. You say, launch if ignition is off. And it makes perfect sense. Rather than if ignition is on, launch. And it doesn't. So it's really kind of a matter of personal taste. You've got the same thing then, if volume equals 10, if ban isn't spine attack. And again, that isn't, it's just the what would normally be exclamation mark equals. It's not equal to. So it's the standard not equal to operator in JavaScript. We then have a third example here, which is call an action unless. So unless is basically if this statement is evaluated to false, then if this statement is evaluated to false, then don't do it. We also have a one-line if statement, so saying if speed is less than limit, then accelerate. So this is not really any kind of great advance over the JavaScript syntax in that case. And then in the last one we have, again, winner equals yes, if pip in, and this basically gives you an in keyword, which is not present in quite the same way in JavaScript. This is basically saying, if this variable is present in this array, then true. So we're saying, here's our array, here's a value, we want to check if it's in the array. So pip in this array, it will return true or false based on whether or not pip is actually in that array. If you look at what that produces in terms of the JavaScript, you already see it's longer, much more syntax, there's lots more things going on. And in general terms, for a lot of those examples, the order in which things are written is reversed. So we always say, we always do the if statement first, and we always evaluate that first, and then we put after that, inside some brackets, what we actually want to happen. Whereas in the CoffeeScript, it's running in a much more natural English kind of language order. We're talking first about the thing we want to do, and then we're talking about the conditions under which we want to do it. So it is a matter of personal preference, and I think this is something that throws a lot of people out when they're using CoffeeScript, and it could be, you know, I think it'd be well worth, sort of, as a development team, if you're working with other people, actually talking about preferences, whether you actually think this is worth doing, and whether you think it's best to just stick with the traditional kind of approach. But if you really, really want to, if your personal coding style or your team's coding style suits this, it does give you a different way of doing the same thing in a lot less space.
Is the compiler
integrated with Unix? You can integrate it. I mean, there's a, for Emacs, there's a CoffeeScript mode. I think for most editors, there will be some text as well, NetBeans, so I imagine. So most editors I use will have some kind of integration.
Do you
want to
see the compression before you head up, or is it like less?
You can do it either way. I have actually got a slide about that on the better side. I'm just going to run through a couple more of these examples. What we've got here is, and this is kind of a bit more of an example of what CoffeeScript really kind of stands for. We've got a really common path here. We've got a variable called speed. We don't know if speed has been defined yet. We don't know if it's null. We don't know really what's in that variable at all. So what this is doing is saying speed question mark equals 15. And this is a shortcut. It basically says if speed hasn't been defined, set it to 15. And this is, you know, I'll just skip forward and show you the JavaScript equivalent. You have to do if speed equals null, then speed equals 15. So you're taking these kind of really common patterns and just turning it into something you can do in a couple of characters, rather than having to write 3 lines of code. We've also got this other one here, footprints equals Yeti question mark fair. And what we're saying is, if Yeti is not defined, set the value of footprints to the string there. And to do that in JavaScript, you have to do in the middle. It involves lots of type of statements and comparing them to strings and so on and so forth. And it's a lot more verbose. I appreciate some of these code examples are going to be a little bit contrived. But you will find situations where you're doing that in all your code, particularly if you're doing larger applications with more kind of complicated code. You find these happening quite a lot. And then we've got another one here. If Elvis is defined, display an alert, otherwise it's going to be okay. Obviously in JavaScript you have to do the type of keyword, and you have to compare in strings and compare things to null. So this basically takes care of that situation where something might be undefined, might be null, you're not sure which of those it is, it just compares for both of them at the same time and lets you know one way or the other, is it defined, is it null. It's not either of those. This is another example of a shortcut that CoffeeScript gives you. And this is actually inserting values into strings. And in PHP, you can do this quite easily. If you've got a variable or a name, and you just put that in the middle of the string, that variable will just be placed in the string. But in JavaScript, you can't do that. You can concatenate it all together or insert that variable into the string. You have to declare each string separately and then use the plus symbol to kind of add them together to concatenate. In CoffeeScript, you can actually insert variables directly into the string using this hash bracket syntax. And what you can see on the third line is that you can actually put expressions in. So you can actually put a sum and insert a sum into the string, or you can do a function invocation. You can actually do a whole lot of stuff there. And have a string come out at the end which contains the result of that computation that it would work. So in this case we've got 22 divided by 7 is a decent approximation of time. This is actually a case where the JavaScript code comes out almost exactly the same. It's very, very similar, except there is more order. Like you could break a string up, you've got to use a plus symbol to put that things together. It's just a little bit funky. I think this is the final kind of code example, and this is CoffeeScript's class keyword, which is, I think for a lot of people, this is a major feature that it has over JavaScript. Now, if you've ever done any object-oriented program at all in Java, or Python, or Ruby, or anything like that, these kinds of things should look quite familiar. You've got a class, and you've got a constructor for that class, which is called when you instantiate the class. That constructor can take the parameter. You've got methods on the class, so in this case we've got animal, and animal has a move method. And then we've got some subclasses of animal, in this case snake and horse, and they both define their own move method. So if you've got an instance of horse, and you move on it, it will send an alert message saying galloping. If you call snake, it will or move on the snake object, it will send an alert saying slithering. This is all kind of pretty bog standard object-oriented stuff that people have been in PHP or Java or any other language for quite some time. This is the JavaScript equivalent. I couldn't fit it all on the slide. And this is because JavaScript just doesn't have a good way of describing class-object relationships in a straightforward way. So what CoffeeScript does, it says, well, here's a way of doing it. We're going to take that, we're going to wrap it behind the class keyword, and we're going to go with that. And what you find in a lot of JavaScript libraries and frameworks is that they each have their own slightly different convention how to do this. You know, if you're doing it one way using Backbone, you're doing it a slightly different way using move tools, and a slightly different way using Ember, and so on and so forth. This really just standardizes. So CoffeeScript will generate all of this boilerplate for you. And this is again output from the CoffeeScript compiler. It gets pre-generated for you, and you don't need to worry about how it works. All you need to worry about is the classes and how they relate to each other. So I think that's possibly the single most kind of obvious example of where CoffeeScript kind of takes something that's quite complicated to do in JavaScript, makes it really, really easy. Just to come back to the question of how we actually use this, when we use it in our projects.
basic ways that you